Can you tell us what it's like for you to be sitting here right now today?
I feel it's a privilege to be here because my father has lived so long, and I get to hear the stories and answers of many other people that tell us about 75 years ago.
What's your earliest memory of the man?
Actually, we never talked about it at home. I thought my dad was a flying tiger because we had a big decal that he'd gotten from the flying tigers over in China, because he got left there after the raid. 26 of them got left in the CBI. But I remember about fourth grade looking through the history books to see if I saw General Doolittle's plane taking off the deck of the Hornet. He didn't talk about it, you know. I even have I have three brothers that are younger, and one of them everybody's old and retired, but he became an F-15 pilot, and they didn't converse about it very much either, so.
How did you learn that? From other people, from your mother?
Yeah, no, I always liked history. But even if I read something and I'd go ask him a question, he'd say, we'll talk about it later, even though he'd answer other people's questions all the time, you know. He just didn't think that it was that relevant. So basically, when I started traveling with him about 20 years ago, questions would come up, and I'd listen to him, and then he would answer my questions too, you know. So,
how does he feel about being the last raider? I mean, it's got to be very lonely for him to come to this event.
It's more than that, because he was 6 years older than Dave Thatcher, and we never talked about him being the last raider, even though he was in very good health. Dave Thatcher was also in very good health, and just the odds were that Dave Thatcher would outlive him. So it was quite a bit of a shock, because Dave didn't have a long illness. He passed away. It was a pretty short time. So, I mean, they knew it was something was coming type thing, but and it's very, you know, it's going to happen. So, but he really doesn't dwell on that. He just sort of can't believe he's the last one. Because he was older on the raid. He was 26.
What do you think it means then to see all these ceremonies, the amount of people that come out, both from military and non-military families, that this raid means so much to them historically, and that he was a part of that?
The part that, from my perspective, all the raiders were very, very shocked that they have been treated this. They feel that their job wasn't any more important than any of the other World War II they are amazed that they are singled out. I understand from watching both sides, the public side and their side, why they're singled out, but at the same time, they never themselves thought it was a one-way mission, suicide mission. They didn't call it that. The media called it that over the years, and the authors called it that over the years. They knew that their job was to go and bomb Tokyo, and they did that. And so they felt that was, they had completed their mission, and they felt that as a success. And at that time, even fifth graders would have joined in on that mission, because Japan was had taken over the whole Pacific. I mean, within a month of the raid, they were bombing Australia, they were bombing into India, and it gave a boost to all the free countries of the world, and that is why they're remembered, because of the that raid set the stage for what was going to come. And they didn't know that that's what, that, but they knew they did their job, and they were proud of that. And they were very happy to help the country out in a difficult time.
Did your mom ever talk about kind of the stories that he might have shared with her, or did he kind of keep quiet with Bill?
No, it was, you know, all of the Raider families and a lot of the World War II families that we talked to, that wasn't a... They did their job, they came home, and they wanted to live their lives and enjoy their lives. And they, you know, talked about everyday situations just like families do today. So.
Did your father stay close to aviation after that?
Oh, yeah. He became, he was able to transfer from the Army into the new Air Force. And so we were a military family. He's been we loved it. We were ready to go every time they said, "You're moving."
Did you get to live overseas? Or
yeah, we lived in Japan 5 years after the war, and we didn't have a base to live on. We lived in private rentals, and we enjoyed it very much. We got to live in South America, private rentals, or on the economy, whatever they call it. And then we had numerous places here in the United States. So.
Your father in the past has said that he does not view himself as a hero in this case. How do you view your father?
I understand, like I said, what the public is thinking and what he's thinking. But at the same time, he's always considered himself extremely lucky, and he was in the right place at the right time, and it worked out. Our country was in a very difficult situation right then, and I'm glad that he and 16 other million military people were able to solve the problem. So I understand being a hero, but I also see his point of view that he doesn't even think that they should be given medals for doing something for the country. So,
if he doesn't think that, how does he view today's ceremonies? How is he feeling?
Well, the ceremony today was because these goblets here. Well, okay, let's back up. The goblets were given to them. They never went out and purchased them. Okay, and so then they would recognize their comrades that had died before them, okay, whether it was World War II or, afterwards, after the war. But that's more out of affection than being tribute to heroes, you know. There was 80 individuals, and none of them had been in combat before. And so they all took the risk. And General Doolittle even basically states that General Doolittle became head of the 8th Air Force after the raid. He was in North Africa, and then he goes to the 8th Air Force. That was thousands of planes and men. And he came back to the Raiders after World War II because he said it's not that he didn't love everybody else under his command, but he just loved them more because they were willing to... They didn't bat an eyelash at following him. They were given chances not to go on the raid if they wanted to back down because they didn't know what they were doing. They were told you're going on a dangerous mission, and that was it. So, and they stepped up and didn't have any problem staying there. So.
What's your father's take on today? I mean, what would you describe that as? How is he feeling?
Well, his take is that he had to say goodbye to another member, which he never thought he would be in this position, you know.
So. How do you think history should remember this?
Well, I think history should remember World War II as unbelievable, because none of us would have anything we have today. So it's not just them, it's all of World War, all Allied forces in World War II.
How did your father feel about the new bombers being named after this famous group of?
He was very, very, very happy with that because you know, we used to pass on a hardware store or a grocery store or something on to our kids, you know, type thing, and that sort of makes a connection from an old past to a new future, because that won't be around. I mean, it'll probably be 5 or 6 years before they even go into production on that. So he was real happy that that has come about, yes.
How proud is he of his two grandkids that are enlisted?
He's very proud of them. He's proud of all of his children. He never asked any of us to go in the service or anything like that. But I know he does get excited when I'll say, well, you know, just finished this and he's doing that or something like that. So, you know, it's something he relates to, and it's, even though it's, you know, he's been retired 50 years. So, I mean, it's a different ball game, but he does have connections with it. And he gets one of the magazines called Air Force Association Magazine, and he reads it cover to cover. And so he keeps up with, you know. And Dad travels a lot, and he's out among planes. It's usually the older planes. We're not on bases that much. But he tries to stay abreast.
Did your father have any contact with during the mission with personnel here like that who might have been with logistics, people that weren't actually on the flight, but people that might have supported the mission and stuff?
Probably not, but Dad was born here in Dayton, Ohio, and Hank Potter, the navigator, and Dad flew with General Doolittle probably about 5 times before the raid, and one of those was when General Doolittle was hop skipping around to all the, because General Doolittle was here trying to perfect the gasoline to a higher octane to get it further. He wasn't actually doing it, but he was working with the scientists that were here to get it so that they could get more power, more mileage out of the fuel. So one of the stops was here. I think they only came here once, but I could be wrong, before the raid, while they were down at Eglin. Okay, March of 42, sorry.
Would you think that there is more known about the Doolittle raid today than at the end of World War II? As far as the common person?
No, I don't think so, because the whole, people come up to us at air shows and they were 9 years old or 5 years old, and they remember the reaction of their parents. And that made a big impression upon them. I mean, at least one or two people each air show. And Dad, like I said, travels a lot. So I think there's more details known about the raid now. I mean, because it has been, it's probably one of the most written about missions in World War II, and it's interesting because there's always new information coming out. It's a big puzzle. 90%, 99% of the pieces are there, but there's a couple of missing pieces, and little by little they're all being, you know, in order, you know, type thing. And then some of it just was plain grace of God that it worked, you know. Because many missions are planned and they don't always work, you know, and they're planned very well. So, but Dad's very happy that General Doolittle was very accomplished in many fields, and he also got the first master's and PhD in aeronautical engineering from MIT. And he's very glad that General Doolittle stays in the history books in the forefront, even if it's just for the Doolittle raid. I mean, he's very much accomplished, but if that keeps him in the books, that's good. That's it.
Okay, thank you.